What's up, Red Devils? This is the only good cooking segment on the Friday show. I'm your host, Wilfred, and while you're enjoying the show today, we're going to be cooking an easy spaghetti meal. Here's the list of the ingredients.
What's going on, LHS? I'm Joey Hewer here at the basketball courts, and I'm here to talk to the basketball team and how they'll do in their up-and-coming games.
The boys' basketball team are coming off a 12-13 season and were able to push deep into the playoffs, making it to the sectional championship game. With a strong junior class stepping up, the Devils are going to be led by junior Christopher Mantis, who led the team in points, rebounds, and assists last year.
Based on how hard you guys have been working, how do you think the season will fare out?
I think, you know, ever since trial team started, coach has been pushing us. People are looking down on us because we're obviously inexperienced. And last year we made it to the championship. We lost 8 seniors. So we've been working hard every day in practice, getting better. And I think as the season goes on, we're going to shock some people. And we just got to get better and get a win tomorrow, hopefully.
With a strong junior class stepping up this year and a few sophomores helping out, the starting lineup consists of Chris Mantis, Caden Vasco, Tyson Chavez, Cam Stoyanovich, and Adam Richardson.
So, Caden, who would you guys say the team's biggest rival or the game you're looking forward to the most is?
I'd say probably Munster, just because we lost them last year in the sectional championship, and they don't really consider us as a rival, but I feel like we're always close with them, and I feel like this year we definitely got a chance of beating them.
Thank you.
The boys' basketball team have an away non-conference bout against the Valparaiso Vikings tonight at 7. Come out to support the boys.
The boys are looking forward to a spectacular season. Thank you to the boys that I interviewed. I'm Joey Hewer from RDN, signing off.
First, we grab the ball. Next, we break the noodles. Then, we add the water.
Here at RDN, we've covered plenty of students and events in our school, but have we given enough coverage to our teachers? Today we're here to bring back our teacher spotlight, and to start, we have the one and only Mr. Flotter. This year's band season went fantastic. They ended up advancing all the way to state, and it's all thanks to him. Hi, I'm Dakota, and I'm here with Mr. Flotter.
Hello.
Today we're asking him questions for our teacher spotlight. Mr. Flotter, how long have you been teaching band?
This is my 8th year teaching band, 10th year teaching music overall.
How does it feel to have made it so far with marching band this year?
It's a greatly successful season. This is our 4th very successful year in a row, but this one was really special. We made some special achievements. The kids worked really hard. Not that they don't always work really hard, but it was just the right show with the right kids at the right time. Feels great.
What was your favorite part of marching band this year?
I think everybody's favorite part is the contests. We go to 4 or 5 contests a year, and just the trip, driving out there, spending the whole day together, having fun, it's a really good time.
Was teaching band your initial pathway, or was it something else?
I made the decision I wanted to teach music when I was a sophomore in high school. Before that, like any good elementary student, I wanted to be an aerospace engineer. But my sophomore year of high school, we were rehearsing in marching band, and I just had this epiphany that this is what I want to do.
What college did you go to, and how many years did you go?
I went to Butler University for my bachelor's and master's degree. All told, those 2 degrees plus my teaching certification ran about 11 years of full-time and part-time student.
Since you've been working at Lowell, what have you done for our theater department?
Well, so one of my jobs is auditorium director, and for the most part that means that I address the technology needs in the auditorium. We update equipment as is necessary. We repair things as is necessary. Most recently, we've been updating our lighting our stage lighting to include a bunch of LED RGB lights that are variable between all colors. They're awesome, and we actually just got them rolling this past week. That's going to be a really huge improvement to lighting for our stage productions.
Has technical theater always been an interest for you?
I've always been interested in it. I was never part of a job until I got here to Lowell, and it was part of the band director job.
Have you ever thought about becoming tech head?
I've always had an interest in that as well, but time just wouldn't allow anything like that. I'm crazy busy in the fall with marching band, and in the spring I've got jazz band, solo and ensemble on alternating years. We also do a pit for the musical. Just not time for it, unfortunately.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Flotter, for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Flotter, for being so loyal to our school. We really appreciate everything you do here at the high school and hope you continue to stand grounds as a renowned band director here at Lowell. That's it for our teacher spotlight this week. Signing off for RDN, I'm Dakota Adams.
Something I do at the beginning of each semester is I take kids up under the gridiron to show them how dangerous it is, and I always bring something to drop. I don't wear plaid shirts.
You don't wear plaid shirts?
Is this plaid?
That is plaid.
And now that we have the noodles in the bowl, we will cook it for 10 minutes.
I'm Alex.
And I'm Grace.
This is my mom, Tara.
And this is my mom, Erin.
Hello.
And so today, we are going to be doing Cooking with Mom, but with a little bit of a twist.
So we are going to be with different moms.
This is my mom now.
And I guess this is my mom now.
Me and Erin here, we're starting off with a strawberry shortcake. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna take some strawberry jello, mash it with butter. We're going to do the same thing with this vanilla jello, and it's going to be like a whole big mix. We got strawberry frosting and our perfectly moist classic white cake mix.
It's a mashing.
Ooh. I've never seen these techniques before.
No. Some fancy booster. You just go until it's all mashed up.
So right now we have our pan, which is just a normal cookie thing with parchment paper. Our oven is set for 350. We're gonna take our mix here, a butter and jello mix, plop it down just like that, flatten it out, but we're gonna alternate a little bit. We're gonna flatten it out, bake it for about 6 to 8 minutes, and then we're gonna crunch it up after. Now, right here, we got 1 cup of water, 1/3 cup of vegetable oil. We got our cake mix and our eggs. And so we're just gonna dump this all into the big green bowl.
And mix this until everything is
cakey. So while she's mixing, I'm going to spray our pan with a nonstick Best Choice Baking with Flour spray.
Now that we have our eggs, oil, and water mixed into the batter, we're just gonna go ahead and dump our own in.
So we are making peanut butter swirl brownies. So the first thing we're gonna need is our brownie mix. And then we have 2/3 cup of oil and we have 1/4 cup of water. We have 2 eggs and we also have 1 cup of peanut butter.
Looks good. So now we can ladle the batter into the little cupcake. And then once the brownie mix gets in, she's going to put a spoonful of the peanut butter swirl in. And then we'll put them in the oven at 350 for about 18 minutes.
All right, here's our crumble. Crumbling. And then we're gonna frost.
There's the crumble.
All right, so now what we're gonna do is put on this powdered sugar here on these brownies, and you can see that they rose a little bit. But we're just gonna get festive and have it do a little snow. No, we're just gonna have fun with it.
This is a blizzard.
We're just having fun.
Ta-da!
That's what we're doing.
And now for our surprise guest, welcome, Charlie Wickman!
Hi, guys.
I can't wait to eat this scrumptious food plate that I've been given here. Looks like some brownie slash cake something. Just gonna get a nice chomp here. I'm just gonna get a bite of this second dish I have here from one of the moms slash kids.
I'm also down with this. This is also very good.
Thank you for watching this segment of Cooking with Mom.
Dig in.
Oh my God.
And while we're waiting, we will open a can of spaghetti sauce.
I'm Heather Rumpfleet, and on November 11th, LHS had a Veterans Day Assembly, so we are here to give you a little recap on the event. This is Emma Kirchhoff, and she sang the national anthem at the Veterans Day Assembly, so we decided to ask her a few questions about herself and her performance. So did you enjoy doing your performance?
I did really enjoy it. When they gave me the opportunity to do it, I was kind of nervous at first because that was the biggest group of people I've ever sang for, but I thought it was a really cool experience.
What made you want to do the performance?
I thought it was cool that they started the new assembly thing to honor the veterans. I just think that was like a cool idea that they started. And so when they told me that I could do it, I was like, oh, that's kind of cool that I can be the first one to do it. So I hope that more people do it in the future and that the assembly keeps going and keeps progressing and being more successful.
Now we're going to talk to David Aldrich about how JROTC also played a part in the assembly. Okay, so did anyone influence your choice to join JROTC?
I was originally told about ROTC through Christian Swears. He had graduated, I want to say, last year, and he had showed me the class and told me all about it.
Ooh. Okay, and did you ever think about joining the military after high school?
That had been my plan for quite a few years. It's recently changed, but I don't think that it's ever a bad idea.
And what made you want to participate in the Veterans Day Assembly?
Ms. Richards had asked me into her office and asked me about it. I had no idea what exactly it was going to consist of, but I was very happy to do it because it was very nice to be able to do something for our veterans for the first time ever.
This is Ms. Richards, and she helped put together a wonderful slideshow for the veterans and the student body to watch at the assembly. So how did you help prepare the slideshow?
Well, actually, I was in charge of putting together the entire Veterans Day program. So I gathered all of the people that I thought would be great contributors to the program, although we have a ton of people who would be. And Mrs. Leslie is an expert in web design and graphics and a lot of different things. So I actually approached her and asked her to help with that. And she was the person really behind putting it together.
And why did the school help hold this event?
Well, historically, we've not done one, and Mrs. Patrick, who's our principal, had come to me, and she said that it was sort of heavy on her heart that we had not, and her husband is a veteran, and many of our, we have the Halls of Honor, and many of our staff and family members here are veterans, and so she said she would be interested in doing it, and so I said I would go ahead and spearhead it, and we went ahead and designed the program, and I'm hoping that every year from here on out, well, I know we will do it, but I'm hoping each year it will become more refined and bigger, and more impactful in our community.
Okay, so Ms. Leslie, we were wondering what your inspiration was behind the slideshow for the Veterans Day Assembly.
My inspiration was just everything the veterans have done for us. I just wanted to do a little something to let them know that we still remember what they did, we appreciate it, and we honor them.
We would like to give a thank you to Emma, David, Ms. Richards, and Ms. Leslie, as well as the veterans for their time.
Sorry about that, guys. I thought I had a bowl in front of me. looks like it's diced tomatoes. I have to crush these now.
What's going on, LHS? I'm Joey Hewer here at the basketball courts, and I'm here to talk to the basketball team and how they'll do in their up-and-coming games.
The boys' basketball team are coming off a 12-13 season and were able to push deep into the playoffs, making it to the sectional championship game. With a strong junior class stepping up, the Devils are going to be led by junior Christopher Mantis, who led the team in points, rebounds, and assists last year.
Based on how hard you guys have been working, how do you think the season will fare out?
I think, you know, ever since tryouts have started, coach has been pushing us. People are looking down on us because we're obviously inexperienced. And last year we made it to the championship, we lost 8 seniors. So we've been working hard every day in practice, getting better. And I think as the season goes on, we're going to shock some people. And we just got to get better and get a win tomorrow, hopefully.
With a strong junior class stepping up this year and a few sophomores helping out, the starting lineup consists of Chris Mantis, Caden Vasco, Tyson Chavez, Cam Stojanovic, and Adam Richardson.
So, Caden, who would you guys say the team's biggest rival or the game you're looking forward to the most is?
I'd say probably Munster, just because we lost them last year in the sectional championship, and they don't really consider us as a rival, but I feel like we're always close with them, and I feel like this year we definitely got a chance of beating them.
Thank you.
The boys' basketball team have an away non-conference bout against the Valparaiso Vikings tonight at 7. Come out to support the boys.
The boys are looking forward to a spectacular season. Thank you to the boys that I interviewed. I'm Joey Hewer from RDN, signing off.
There's a bit too much water in this. Gotta make sure it's not clogged. There's a lot of vitamins in there.
Hi guys, today I'll be reviewing D&D. D&D is a role-playing game, and I will be playing it with some of my friends. Now, because it's a long game, I'm going to give you my opinions at the end, but before that, I will give you interviews with more experienced players, and I hope you like it.
It's the overall, like, multiple branching paths. It's a RPG stands for role-playing games. You can basically do whatever you want. That's with, like, means of possibility. You use dice to simulate randomness, and it's just a bunch of branching paths. It's fun. You could have, like, different branches of a fight or just different branches of an adventure. Sometimes you get to do where you can, like, go on multiple different quests and you can do different things. It just really depends. Very long, very short. If you're doing, like, a normal D&D game, the overall time it can last, like, all together, is it can take multiple days. It can take a very long time. You meet up for like an hour, you play. Or they can be very short, where they only take 2 or 3. Overall, like, a good session is two hours, sometimes more. There can be, like, different versions. There's, like, different editions. I guess they have, like, different classes and things like that, just new things added in. They, like, update the game, I guess you could say, with different things, depending on the version. Like, different spells, different enemies, things like that. You don't really need much. You don't really need anything, mainly just dice. That's about it. And you also need somebody willing to DM a game that knows how to do it.
I don't really have one, but I tend to play spellcasters. Specifically, sorcerers. And specifically, of sorcerers, a wild mage.
I really
like the just fantasy nature of it. And I also like the fact that it's like with actual people. Try a non-spellcaster. It's just a lot easier. And you might want to start with one of the standard races, like an elf, like human, or a dwarf, or a halfling. Not like a tiefling, or a gnome, or a dragonborn, or a drow.
This game, D&D, surprised me. It was actually pretty fun. The game works basically by having like paths, like branching paths, which is amazing. I like it when games have like branching paths, because that means every like playthrough is going to be different, even if you're starting with like the same thing. And from what I understand, you can start differently every time. Like, you don't have to start at a hotel that's burning and fighting this certain Ling's boss. You could be like in front of a house that's perfectly fine, or maybe you're in the tundra or something. I don't know. I haven't gotten that far into it, but from what I could tell with my experience in this game so far, it seems like it's a fun game. And what's interesting to me is all you need is good internet access, a printer, and some dice. And I found that really interesting, and I found it pretty cool how it only needs that much to be able to play. So, that's all. Signing out.
Make sure you wear gloves, it is very hot. Put the noodles back in the bowl. And I'll see you after this segment. Now that it's cooled down, it's time to eat. This reminds me of my son. And that's all for the Friday show. Thank you for watching Wilfred Cooks, and we'll see you next time, Red Devils.
Welcome back, LHS.
This week's Friday show.
This week we're going to be baking holiday cookies.
Which in reality just means chocolate chip cookies.
So we're going to start off with our quarter cup of flour.
Now what we have to do is sweep it up. Okay, so we're going to pick up our trusty broom. Wait, Haley, didn't a guy fall in love with one of these things?
I think so.
baby, why don't you come over here and give me some sugar? Right now, I need it.
Oh yes, absolutely, I love you because you're so handsome and cool and swag. We make out into the daylight together.
Hey, baby, why don't you come over here and give me some sugar?
Get away from me.
Hey, yo, we gonna have a problem here, bro.
Oh, you're one of those incel types, aren't you? Well, I have a few words for you. You know, you shouldn't be relying on society too much for supplying you everything just because you don't go out and get that effort for yourself.
Really?
Got mail.
Bella, I really wish that I could find like a really good cupcake recipe.
I do too. Every time I try and make cupcakes, they always burn.
You know what? Let's wait for the next segment where they show us how to make the perfect cupcake.
Now you're thinking.
Hi, I'm Taku.
I'm Natalie.
And today you'll be seeing us create our own holiday cupcakes.
Sweet silver bells all sing to say, throw cares away, Christmas is here, bringing good cheer to young and old, me and the world, ding-dong, ding-dong, that is their song, with joyful ring, all caroling, one seems to hear words of good cheer from everywhere, filling the air, oh, how they come, praising the sun. Thank you. marching from everywhere, feeling the air. Oh, how they come, praising the sun. Oh, in a day, tale in a chance, gaily they ring, while people sing songs of good cheer. Christmas is here.
Thanks for watching our segment. Now you know how to make your own delicious holiday cupcakes.
Bella, what are your plans for winter break?
I don't know. I was just thinking we can go ice skating or something like that.
Yeah, I agree. I was kind of wondering what other people in our school were doing.
Me too.
We're out here and we're going to be interviewing people on what they're doing over winter break. So let's head out. So what are you guys doing for our winter break?
I'm going to Traverse City, Michigan.
I'm going on a cruise.
So what are you doing over winter break?
Over winter break, I'm definitely going to sleep. Just a lot of sleep. Aww. And then I'm going to wake up and I'll probably look at the clock and go back to sleep. So I can't wait to go to sleep.
What are you doing over winter break?
Sleeping and working.
So, what are you doing over winter break?
Whole lot of nothing.
For Christmas, what do you guys want for Christmas?
Food?
Okay.
A car.
What are you most excited for winter break?
Working probably every single day.
Grandma.
Interview for the Friday show. It's about winter break.
Is the microphone off?
Nah, I'm good.
Alright.
Oh, okay.
Is it on?
No.
Is it on?
Yeah, it's flipped up. It's on. Shit, I alerted them.
I didn't
notice. I just thought it was on.
You know, Bella, maybe it won't be that bad, Bert.
I don't know. I think it'll still be pretty bad. It's pretty bad.
Welcome to the Channel 12 Cooking Station. I'm Jack Plumley, and I'm going to be your host today. Today we're going to be making some grilled cheese and banana soup. Here are some of the delightful ingredients you'll need for today's recipe. Number one, bananas, obviously, for the banana soup. And you're going to need some lemon and uncut lemon. These are very important for the grilled cheese. We're going very off the board for the cheese, you know, outside the box. We're trying something different. We're doing string cheese today. And for the bread of the grilled cheese, we're using hot dog buns because we're being different today. And we're gonna have a secret sauce that we'll reveal later that's just gonna top off the dish. So for our first ingredient, we're gonna need our hot dog bun. So we're just gonna spread that out on the table right here. And next ingredient is very simple. We just put our stick cheese in here, our string cheese. And then we're gonna top it off with the sauce. Some horseradish. Wonderful. Okay. Oh, it's on my finger. It's on my finger! Okay, now it's ready to go on the stove. Now on to Kerry in Studio 2 with the soup.
Hey, it's Kerry Justice. And you know what I think what time it is? It's soup time. See, this is what you do to get it nice and tender. You just gotta get all nice and smothered up. Can you hear that? Folks at home. Then we put the super secret sauce. How do you open this? There we go. Then we gotta go. So good. Now we got the horseradish in there, the super secret sauce. Time for salt and pepper. And then just... we don't want to add too much pepper. We've had our fun here. Now, old friend, it's time for you to get in the toaster. Now we'll see how Jack is doing with the grilled cheese in Studio One.
One man. One tree. One Jacinda. Walking through the forest with one quest. One to get the tree. One to stop the other. We're here with Nathan, following him on his quest to capture the Christmas tree. This is a man with sheer determination. You can see it in his eyes. He wants that Christmas tree. But what are his true interior motives with the Christmas tree? Only time may tell. Now we will observe Jacinda. Her only motive is to stop Nathan, it seems. She wants him out of that forest. She does not want him to capture the Christmas tree. She will do anything in her power to stop Nathan, it seems. She can't have him capture that Christmas tree for whatever reason. Only through our observation of these happenings will we be able to tell. Now back to Nathan. I am astounded by the overwhelming sense of determination flowing from him. I just hope his motives are just.
Wow, dude. My actions are like so not just. This is dope.
Well, looks like he's a lost cause. And now we're back here with Jacinda. I do believe she has set up a trap in order to capture Nathan. Based on our observation of Nathan, I am rooting for our newfound hero. It seems Nathan has found his perfect specimen. Well, it seems our hero is victorious and the integrity of the forest is saved. Till next time.
Thanks for tuning in to this week's Friday show.
Be sure to tune in next week.